Hello there. I'm Stephen Hartley from Banbury, United Kingdom. It is Tuesday night, well, it's gone past midnight here in the UK. What are we on? 20. Now the 29th of May. Okay. And this video is essentially going to be about what to do if the catastrophe comes and we kind of need to survive without state, things like that we've got used to. Okay, so I guess the people listening to this video are, in a sense, those more in tune with their self, you know, the real us, our soul, and not too engrossed in the rat race and the bullshit, basically, because yeah, if you've just been listening to the news, then yeah, you're not gonna have a clue what's going on, because what they mentioned, one sinkhole in Florida and a tornado the other day, they're not covering it properly. There's just, okay, this video isn't about that, because we've got loads of videos about that, and that, you know, watching these videos kind of makes me feel a bit sick. It's not good, so I won't go into that. Right. I have been feeling pretty weird though the last few days. I don't know if anyone's not watched Astral Traveller, it's worth a watch. His latest videos, certainly. It looks like he's proved with all his, or her, I don't know, with all their stuff, that Nibiru is definitely here. Again, sorry, not the purpose of this video. So yeah, I've been feeling a bit weird, and apparently like Nibiru is sucking out all the positive magnetics, like the protons, and just leaving us with these loads of electrons. Don't know if that's the cause of it, could be. Been having naps in the day a lot, sort of completely wiped out. Yeah, even though I've been, probably haven't been eating brilliantly, I've been eating better than I was a year ago anyway, so been eating alright. Anyway, so if anyone else is feeling weird, maybe it's the radiation or what's going on. And if it is Nibiru, then it's probably going to get worse. I tried making an aluminium foil hat, and that did sort of seem to help, but yeah, that was before. I'm sorry. Really hope you've got time to waste listening to this. Better be working. Did I press record? I might trim these bits out, or just leave it. Well, look, you know, we've got time, haven't we? Got to loosen up the old tongue and stuff. Okay, so I'm assuming I'm talking to human beings, so please forgive me. As humans, we have massive ability to forgive, which is good. And we are good. We've just been tricked. We've just been fooled. And we've been deceived by some very clever beings. I mean, can you imagine? I believe the sort of the control has been going on for 6,000 years, aka Babylon. And, you know, can you imagine us sort of trying to discuss this sort of stuff a couple of hundred years ago? or even 100 years ago. I know the Victorians had almost an enlightenment phase. But this is the day. This is the day it seems to all be cooking off. Kicking off. So, right. On to what I was going to talk about. Okay, now, how are we going to live without the system? Because my gut feeling is right. I feel that the people who have been controlling us, and they certainly want us to, and think that we will tear each other apart if the system falls down. And, you know, maybe there will be some elements that try and do that. Maybe the youth, because they haven't sort of been around long enough to learn. So, and they've been oppressed like mad at school. I mean, it was bad for me at school. It's got to have been even worse for these kids. They've just been more and more controlled. So yeah, the youth are probably going to go wild at the beginning. So, you know, I think it's the responsibility of more elders, more mature elements of society, people with children, I'm thinking, to help the youth, you know, to calm them down. In the first days of this, you know, the shops are going to empty. And, you know, panic buying, people are going to stock up. Inevitably, you're going to have clashes. Inevitably, you're going to have people stealing food from other people once the shops are empty. Now, I would like to make a point here and say, my idea would be to go down to the local shop, and, you know, kind of before things get too out of hand, and if you see one instance of someone sort of getting all panicky and grabbing food, or, you know, just to sort of try and calm them down. And in a sense, what I want to say to you all, and a lot of you might know this, but maybe many of you don't, that, you know, there is really no major need to worry about starving in this country. As long as it all doesn't ice over, or, you know, you can always get food. And the other thing is, you know, how much you need food. You don't actually need it as much as you think. You know, you're going to need food if you're using a lot of energy. So my recommendations would be, first of all, to know that the food in your intestines will feed you for 3 days. You'll get nutrients from that for 3 days. So you can go 3 days without food easy. And you'll feel a bit weak after a while. I haven't done more than 3 days, personally. But, you know, you hear about people who fast for 40 days. And, you know, your stomach will get to the point where you think, well, you're not going to get any more food. And, yeah, you, in fact, after a while, apparently, you don't want to eat. So, but you're going to need water. Now, rainwater is okay to drink. Okay, take it from me, I've been doing it for a year. So it might set me mad, but I feel good. It's much better than fluoride tap water. Feel definitely. Anyway, so you can drink rainwater, just need something to collect it in. So if you're going to go and panic buy anything, go and panic buy a water butt and get that set up. You know, even if you haven't got that, you could chew grass. Just chew it, and you get the juice out of it, and then spit out the pulp. Okay? So you're not going to starve. You can eat most wild things in this country. Dandelion leaves, really, really full of vitamins. Okay? So we're not going to go without vitamins. most leaves, you can probably just look at them. Some of them, if they look really waxy, like ivy leaves, or some leaves on a tree like sycamores, they're probably not edible, don't bother with those. But you can sometimes see they look, you know, the leaf looks thick and luscious. Try chewing a little bit. You know, some of them are quite strong tasting. Now that's very good. The stronger the taste, the more goodness it will have in it. If it's bitter, it's probably medicinal. So you can eat this stuff. Also ants, worms, you can eat them and they're easy to catch. So we're not going to starve. And if everything burns down, if we don't get somewhere where things grow, then that's going to make things more difficult, obviously. If we can dig for roots, we can chew on roots and there's water in those roots. So it means getting down and dirty, but you don't need to stock up 1,000 cans of baked beans, because really you're just making yourself a target. Now, the most ideal thing to do would be to share everything out equally. Yeah. Okay, we know that could work, but we also know that could be difficult. So, that's one thing. Can sort of reduce the panicky feeling that everyone has to stock up on food, hoard it and guard it. Okay, that is a waste of time. And it's the wrong thing to do. That's what they want us to do. They want us to tear ourselves apart. So, please keep watching this video. If you know what we can do, what the answer is to go and knock on your neighbour's door. As much as we may not perhaps get along with them all the time. Because in a sense, the society is designed, the houses have been built to all make us feel secluded in our little private area where we can do our private things. And apparently that's the ultimate way of life. So, but when the system comes crashing down, we are quite weak. Individually, you know, even your hero characters on TV, you know, they need engagement with people. We feel much better when we have a community. So, the rules with community is, I believe, to keep the numbers to around 150 people. That is the natural size for a human tribe. I've done a video on it before. Any smaller and it can sort of not be strong enough to stay together. And any bigger and it will sort of split into two. So maybe that'll happen naturally. But to have that idea in mind, that that's the number of people that would get on best with that. Big enough to be strong enough, and then you can, with 150 people, you can be much more efficient. You can have some people on guard, you can have some stockpiles of food which you can share, you know, and making plans, and you'll have more resources because 150 people, maybe 15, 20 houses, I don't know, it depends. So obviously complete mixed age range, from kids to old age. So not everyone's going to be really helpful, but a good number are. And you'll have more gardens and things that you can start growing. Now, you can try and get a hold of seeds. Or, you know, try and get some couple of animals or something. Chickens maybe, you know, and start surviving basically until the way forward becomes clear. Survival is going to be the name of the game. Who knows, don't know what's going to happen, but, you know, you've got to have some sort of plan in mind. So presuming that the world is going to be okay to sort of grow things or whatever, then we should be fine. And stick together in communities. Not tear ourselves apart. One quick word about pets. You know, I think we've got to be pretty ruthless with pets. Dogs and cats are carnivores. We can't really afford to be feeding them for just, you know, just to have a lovable animal around us. I mean, that's probably why we have pets, because our communities have been taken away from us. So we're plugging in the gap with a pet. So cats, you know, it's probably might be useful to have the odd cat, because to keep down other sort of vermin. But, you know, I think there's too many cats around. So I think, you know, some of them should become, maybe dog food. Sorry. And the dogs, there's also too many of them. And I don't want to offend people. You know, people love their dogs. But alright, you know, a lot of humans are going to die. And we've got to reverse a 6,000 year devolution of our species. Maybe we have to be a bit drastic. Now, what I would recommend, I'm not going to be king anyway, am I? So it's not like I can enforce my will. But what I would recommend is that some dogs be kept as aids for guarding, and they should be the more purebred, I would have said. You know, Labradors and Alsatians, you know, and again, they need a lot of food. Or just dogs that, you know, may be useful to us rather than just, you know, a liberty which needs to eat a lot of meat. And then shits. Sorry, wasn't planning to talk about that. Yeah, I think that's it, actually. No, it's not. Now, the one thing that's going to make the future different, the one thing that's going to stop this happening all over again, is that we humans got to step up. Or like I say, undo 6,000 years of devolution. We were cleverer then, we were fitter, and we were more spiritual. And I think we probably knew our souls better. We are souls. You know, we have been around forever. You know that. The me inside you, which cannot face the possibility of ceasing to exist. As far as I'm aware, we all have it. Animals as well. This has to control us. This is what we are. It's what we should be. We just want to live in peace and harmony, enjoy the company of others. It's this mindset that we must hold on to, but nurture and make more powerful, because we're capable of a lot. Our imagination, as a wizard recently spoke about, is an anything machine. You can get access to all the knowledge, past, present, future. It is there. We have to learn how to use it. Now, my first tip is the subconscious, which is what this is, which has the link to all the knowledge. And you can, if you want, think of your brain as an aerial connection to that. It's like we're only using the front bit all the time, thinking. Tea is a possible cause for that. So get in contact with your soul, with your subconscious. It's quick. I ask you a question, your subconscious will react so quickly. Your brain then will say to you, well, that can't be right because that came too quick, and it disregards it. So you've got to unlearn that. When it comes quick, it's right. And hold on to that original feeling. It's primitive, but it's got more information there than you think. It's not just about what you see. There's information there. You can go back to it, keep it pure, try and glean a bit more information from it. And once you start learning how to do it, you'll recognize what's right and what's wrong. Thoughts, words in your head is not your subconscious. If you've got someone repeating something to you, do that, do that, do that, then that's not your subconscious. That's your usual day-to-day confusion machine, as a wizard was referring to it, I think. So your imagination, this subconscious, is an anything machine, again, as this wizard put it, which I quite like. And you can twiddle with the knobs of your anything machine. You know, you can sit here and think, I'll go to a planet in Sirius. And you could be there. You could observe. I don't know. I wouldn't know how to do anything other than that. Or you can use your anything machine when you're interacting with people. And you can kind of emotionally detach yourself from a situation and do the right thing instead of the wrong thing, which makes things worse, creates problems. You don't need problems. So you don't need to create them. Most people do. So that's going to be the difference. That's why we're not going to go down the same line again and make the same mistake again. 6,000 years time from now, we're going to be wicked. We're going to be interstellar travelers. We're going to be telepathic completely, the people we have contact with. We're not going to need a mobile phone. We're not going to need the internet. Would all be accessible. Right? That's right. So you do want to survive, because it's going to be awesome. And whoever these people are who have oppressed us for 6,000 years, They're going to guess what's coming to them. We don't have to do anything about it. Because there is a higher power out there. And it does deal out the justice. And I don't believe any species can become interstellar without having first achieved some sort of benchmark that stops them from wanting to fight and kill other people. War. It's murder on a massive scale. It's not necessary. Anyway, I think that's covered it. So, you know, it's up to all of us, actually, not to lose our heads. Live life as the soul that you are. And I will try to, because it's not always easy. Anyway, peace and love. Feel it.